offer is liquors and cigarettes.
Picturesque day in late August next to the Thames. Mm-hmm. The Thames is low right now.
Very low. I think this is about as low as it gets, actually. Probably find a few bodies of, diplomats floating around in there. That's what they do.
Really? Mm? Dump them in the Thames? Mm. Is that a London tradition?
I think, it's London tradition to kind of dump bodies in. Well, at one time, they dumped everything in the Thames. You know, it was the only kind of sanitation. So it was the drinking water, plus it was also the sewage system. So as you can imagine, that wasn't so great for personal hygiene in those days. But it's changed a lot since then, I'm told. I still wouldn't go for a swim in it, I tell you.
Well, it happened years ago, when you lived on Stanhope Road. We listened to your sister when she came home from school, 'cause she was 2 years older and she had boys in her room. At least outside I heard her. All right.
You were just in America for the first time recently.
I was, yeah. Well, we were, even to use the royal plural, yeah. It was a funny experience because we weren't actually playing, we were only talking and eating. Did a lot of eating and shaking hands, of course. Which was, it was just, I suppose it was to introduce us to people in America. We talked on radio and things like that. But I'm looking forward more to actually going and playing, because that's the real thing. It's all a bit abstract if you're just talking about things all the time. Eventually you have to see the product, don't you? You can kind of build it up so much, but there has to be something behind it in the end.
I hid inside her wardrobe, and she came home round four, and she was with some kid called David. From the garage up the road, I listened outside, I heard her.
What do you think the reception is going to be like? Do you think that the kind of pop personality that British pop bands have is something that America welcomes easily?
I really don't know. I mean, I think in the end, you can't worry about things like that. It's like a blind date, I think. You know, if someone sets you up on a blind date, you're quite keen on the idea. You've no idea about what the other person's like. You hope that it's going to work out well, because you need some love and affection in your life or whatever. But there's no guarantee. So you just have to go along to the blind date and try and give a good account of yourself. You know, don't get too pissed before you go. And, oh, I love that. Oh, you're really good looking. You know that. Because you're not going to get very far.
He changed his mind last Monday, so you got to leave by Sunday.
There's something that seems completely indicative of the British pop arena, and that is how scenes happen so fast and then disappear. You were associated most recently with something called the crimpoline scene.
Yeah. Well, that's dead. I'm glad to say crimpoline is, there was a great bonfire of man-made fibers, and it's dead now.
But in truth, these so-called scenes don't last that long, do they? And why do they happen in the first place? Is it just a desperate need to have this scene that you can then disassociate yourself with right away because no one really wants to be in a scene? It's really a bizarre kind of frenzy to be in it and out of it very fast.
But I don't think there's ever much of a frenzy on the part of the bands to be involved in the scene. I think it's just because in England the music papers come out every week, so there's a real high turnover of stuff to write about, so they're constantly having to find new things to write about.
Well, at least there's someone better that you can turn to. And you never have to face up to the night on your own. Jesus, it must be great to be straight.
Can you say, having a grown up in Sheffield and lived in London for a number of years, and basically experience, most of your life experience has been in Britain. Are there British truisms about the British? Are there absolute truisms that you can say, yeah, that's like a Brit?
I think that thing about reserve, British reserve, is quite true in some way. That British people tend to be more reserved. The thing I found when I went to America was that there's not much in the way of shading. Things are either one thing or the other, good or bad, cool or it sucks, or whatever, do you know what I mean? It was like, there wasn't much like, that's not bad, that's kind of okay, in, you know, but could be improved slightly. You know, there's not very many shades of meaning. It's kind of oomph or oomph, very kind of simple, one side of the fence or the other. I think there's a lot more, it's probably an English vice, there's a lot more kind of prevaricating and kind of, well, I'm not quite sure whether, maybe, I'm not sure. You know, there's a lot of dithering.
Do you remember the first time? I can't remember the worst time. Well, but you know that we've changed so much since then. Oh, yeah, we've grown.
The perception of punk in Britain. And the perception of punk in America were quite different. What's your perception of what punk is, and is punk still here?
In England, no, I don't think so. The thing that was a big deal about it here was that it was a real... It was one of the rare times when it was something that you had to have an opinion on, and it was... More than it was a musical thing, it was a big social thing. You know, people like Malcolm McLaren haven't got much time for. I think they saw it as a kind of fashion thing or whatever. It was a lot more than that for people in the North. Often they kind of take things more to heart. And it was quite serious. And I think now, maybe I was wrong to say it doesn't live on anymore, but I know people who were involved in that thing who are now, like, you know, parents and stuff. And they're not walking around with green luminous hair and bondage trousers whilst they're taking the kids to school. But they've still got that mental attitude that they're not going to do things the conventional way.